Hello, 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 hello! How are we all doing? How are we doing? Happy Monday! Hey Faisal! Hi Jamie! How you doing? Hello everybody! What time do I call this? I call this 6:15. What's wrong with that? What's wrong with that? I was ready. So, we make a start. We make a start. At whatever time we're ready. I used to sit and wait. If I said that, oh, I don't start my stream until 6 o'clock, I would sit at my desk and wait until it ticked over to 6 o'clock. And now I'm just like, no, do you know what? If I'm ready, I'm ready. And this way you get extra time, right? That's what I'm thinking. I will just do it when I'm ready. So there we go. So anyway, how is everybody? I hope you all had a great weekend. Did you have a great weekend? I hope you did. I hope you did something nice. What was I going to do first? I can't remember what I was going to do first. I think finish this section on the neck. I had a lovely relaxing weekend. Do you mean you thought I start at 5:30? No. My starting time officially, according to my schedule, if you look at my schedule, it says 6:00. Are you giving me a late mark, sir? Please don't mark me late, sir. I tried to get her as early as I could, sir. You going to make me go and stand in a corner? Think about what I've done. Ignore everything. Okay. Oh, it's Monday. It's Monday, isn't it? Everyone gets that Monday start to the week where it's just like, oh God, it's Monday. Brain hasn't switched on yet. Let's use the dark indigo. Just have this coming out of the black. So I got, as I said on Discord, my kids for Mother's Day got me Minecraft, Java edition, whatever that means. And so I will be streaming that at some point this week, to do a like a play an initial play through. I have no idea what I'm meant to do with Minecraft. I have no idea what the aim of the game is, whether there are missions, what the story is, what the bad guys are, if you get attacked, if you don't get attacked, How you're supposed to defend? I have no idea. The only thing that I know about Minecraft is when I've seen other people play it, that you chop blocks a lot. That is it. That is my knowledge of the game. So when we get started playing that, I am going to be relying on you guys to tell me what I need to be doing, or to help me in some way, because I don't know. And for ages I've had people telling me I need to stream Minecraft, and so, you know, now I've got it. So I'm hoping it holds my attention. Did I watch any movies this weekend? No, I did look for Iron Claw. But it said, when I googled where can I watch Iron Claw, it said that it was out at cinemas. It didn't seem to be anywhere. I thought when you recommended it that it was on BBC iPlayer, or, you know, one of the apps, Netflix or something, that I could watch it on. And so I didn't see it anywhere. But no, I've not watched any movies that I can recall. If I have, they're not memorable enough for me to remember off the top of my head right now. I did start watching CSI season 10. So I can join James's server, apparently. Apparently, yes. But I think I need to learn the game first before I join anybody's server. I don't want to come across as a total noob on James's server, where I'm sure you all know exactly what you're doing. I think I need to sharpen this pencil. Yes, let me sharpen this pencil because it's not going into the little bits. It's better. It's going into all these little crevices in the paper now. Looks like I forgot I was a pirate for that. Right. Okay. Zipped. Okay. You accidentally came across it. Understood. You swore it was on Netflix. Okay. I'll tell you what I was doing today. I was being a very good girl and I decided to do a bit of a cleanup of my PC. So I was going through the folders and files and just sort of getting rid of a lot of rubbish stuff that didn't need to be kept. So having a bit of a digital clear out. And because as a writer, you just tend to you get an idea and you just sort of tap it out and you save it. You get another idea, you tap it out, you save it. And sometimes you start stories and then realize they're not going anywhere, but you keep them because you think, well, just in case, might need them. And so I decided to go through all of that today and just try and get rid of some of the rubbish that really was rubbish. Not that I'm a very good judge of deciding whether something is really rubbish. But if there was something that didn't have much work to it and it was just a couple of lines, then I ditched it. Unless it was a really good idea, obviously, and then that went into a separate file. But yeah, I went through and had a good old digital clear out today. And so my computer feels less weighed down by stuff. Because I was getting to that stage where I would open up my documents folder and there'd be all these titles for all these different things, and I'd be like, what's that about? What's that about? Oh, I can't be asked to look in there, I'll check it later. I never did. Whereas this time, I actually went in and checked everything and deleted a load of stuff. It always feels quite good to have that done. Right, purple, purple, purple. Wherefore art thou purple? So I'm just going to blend these colors in, and like I said, later I'm going to probably going to try and work out how to put glitter on here without there being any evidence of the glue holding it on, because I don't want the glue to ruin the drawing or to sit on top of the drawing so it can be seen. So I'm just going to put the color in that goes in underneath and then work out how to add the glitter later. The note app on my phone is just filled with random stuff that I don't remember why I put them, but I will never delete them. Yeah, I've got a lot of stuff on my notes app too. I do try and go in and clear it up though. I just don't like clutter, even digital clutter, so I just have to go in and just sort of get rid of it. I tell you, I've been playing a lot of A Little to the Left today. And I did get the DLC Cupboards and Drawers edition, and I think I've nearly completed it, to be fair. I love doing that. I've played a little bit of the unpacking, but I've decided I don't really like the unpacking because the game sets up. I've realized the thing I don't like about unpacking is sometimes you can't tell what the objects are, so you don't know what room they need to go in. But also, because it's done like a diary, so it like the first entry is like 1997 or something, and then the next thing is to the year 2000, and then the next is the year 2004. And so you're following this person as they move into different places and are unpacking. And so a lot of their items are the exact same items that obviously they take with them as they grow up. They keep some things that are sentimental. Occasionally there are newer things. But most of the time you're pulling the same items out of the boxes. And it's just like, there just doesn't seem to be anything new about it. There doesn't seem to be, I don't know, there just doesn't seem to be anything about it that makes me go, oh yes, this is a good game. Whereas with A Little to the Left, Cupboards and Drawers, I just find that really, really enjoyable and soothing. So I really, really like that. Play it on stream. I know, I should, but I always want to play it in the afternoon. Well, maybe if there are still some levels left, I'll play it on Wednesday or something. I definitely prefer the Cupboards and Drawers edition because I just like how everything has its own little slot and you've got to work out how to fit everything under the sink, or you have to fit everything into the cutlery drawer, or you have to fit everything into the fishing tackle box, and I've just really, really enjoyed that. Oh, look, I've smudged. How have I smudged? Oh, it's on this knuckle. Damn it. Let's see if I can lift that off. I think I might have rescued it. Okay. Whew, okay. That was a bit scary. Right. Few, definitely few. For sure. Don't want to put all this work into a picture and then ruin it by smudging it. So, Jamie, you were going to watch the boxing. What did you think to it? I think I saw somewhere that Anthony Joshua won. Was it a good match? Is that who you were rooting for? Do. Load of fudging poo poo. Is that because it ended after like two rounds or something? And so you were like, what was the point of that? Oh dear, I think that's funny. Was just, oh, I'm ready, then, oh, it's over, corner. Yeah, I thought it might be that. Thought that might be the case. Inside me, I wanna let it go. Be follow where I go. The storm becomes the night. I'll guide you through the lightning. Stay close by my side. Like the banting, nicotine, lolly, the bayakat. tantas que acá se encontraba de así. De tu bandimicticnari, tu vaya gatos que a gatos encontraba de así. Been looking forward to getting onto these scales. But did you have a good Mother's Day? Happy late Mother's Day. Yeah, it was nice and quiet. Nick wasn't here because he'd gone off to visit his mum, who was in hospital. And she's okay. And I sort of stayed here and I want to say let the kids look after me, but it was just a pretty much a standard day really, only it just meant that I didn't have to do any cleaning or tidying or cooking, and it was just like, I'm not lifting a finger. If you guys want any of that done, you're just going to have to do it yourselves. And yeah, I sat and I read for a bit. I refused to do any writing on that day, so I took the day off from writing. And I had a little bit of, I say a lay-in, but I got up at 7:30. But I made Nick get up first so that he had to take care of all the animals. Because I was like, I'm not getting up first and having to take care of all the animals, letting them out and feeding them and watering them and giving the ones that need their medications, because it's all such a faff first thing in the morning. And I was just like, someone else could do that. So Nick, you may get up and do that for me. So he did that. And then it was just like a leisurely day. I did a lot of reading. I played some games. I did some more knitting on my jumper, and that's coming along really well. I've got the first line of skulls that goes around the neck, and I've just started on the crossbones. So I got that done. We had a bit of faff downloading Minecraft, because James did it for me. But when I tried to download it, it said, you already have this. And I was like, what? Why would I already have this? I don't have this on my computer. But what had happened was when James was a wee little beastie many, many years ago and wanted Minecraft, it was done through my account. So it was like, oh, okay. So we just had to sort of re-download it onto this computer. And there was just a lot of, oh, you've signed into the Microsoft store with something that's not your launch login, why is it different, blah 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 blah. And I had to keep going back and forth to sort of trying to verify it. And you know, they always send like verification codes to your phone, and it was sending it to my phone, it was sending it to my email, and then it was sending it to an email address that I haven't used for ages. So I then had to get into that email address. Couldn't get into that email address without going to my rescue email address. So it sent me codes for that. And it was just, I just felt like I was being sent all over the place for trying to get all these different ready codes. But eventually we got it sorted out. And Nick got home about, I want to say about 6 or 7 o'clock in the evening. So yeah, it was nice and relaxing. And then life went back to normal again this morning. I spoke to my mum, and that was quite good too. So it was one of the very first phone calls that I've had with her where She didn't cry at the end when she had to say goodbye. And so that's nice, because there's always a sense of, there's always like a little sense of apprehension when you know that that's going to happen. And so you're sort of thinking to yourself, okay, how can I start to say, well, I ought to get going now, Mum. Yeah, I need to get going now, Mum. I've got a few bits and pieces to do. And she never always before, she never used to want to let you go. So it'd be like, why? Why are you going? What have you got to do? And you'd have to try and come up with something, and she'd be, oh, you can let that go. You don't need to do that now. No, I need you to stay on me. Please don't leave. Please. And she would, plead and beg, please don't leave me, and things like that. And so it used to make the phone calls really, really difficult. But today was the first time I didn't have that in like, God, how long has she been in there? A year and a half? 18 months? Nearly 2 years? That's the first time in 2 years I was able to have a phone call that did not end with a massive guilt trip. Yeah, there is more I can add to that, but I'm not going to. There was, yeah. Not everybody has, shall we say, a perfect or good relationship with one or more parents. And so sometimes that can be a little bit difficult, but thanks, Jamie. It must have been difficult for you as well on Mother's Day. I think that's the thing with Mother's Day, is that a lot of people out there assume that everyone has got a fabulous relationship with their mother, or that they still have their mother, or that everything is hunky-dory. And it's like days like that, whether it's Mother's Day, Father's Day, whatever, it can be really difficult for some people who don't still have that parent, or people who don't have a good relationship because their childhood was a difficult upbringing for whatever reason. And I think sometimes when people express that or try and express that, a lot of times they get shot down or told, oh, you should just be grateful that you've got a mother, sort of thing. And it's like, well, I get what you're saying. I do. And I'm really happy for you that you have a great relationship with your mother or your father or whatever. But not everybody has that. And I think those people should be allowed to say that not everything is perfect. It's not the best day, but at least I save money on flowers. This is true. This is true. See, Nick always saves money on flowers on Valentine's Day, because obviously the traditional flower to give is red roses, and I don't like red roses. So I've always said to him, I actually prefer tulips. So he always gets me tulips, which of course are a lot cheaper. So he gets to save money on things like that as well. I mean, to be honest, I just class it a good Mother's Day if I can get away with not having to cook and not having to clean and not having to get up to be first to do the animals. That to me is just a good day. Oh, and as long as I get a little bit of chocolate that I can eat as well, so that's fine. Very low maintenance. I've never been a high maintenance person. I did one of those. Know, you can do like those personality tests. You can do like those Myers-Briggs tests, and you can do Enneagrams and things. And I kept thinking I've never done the Enneagram one, and so I did the Enneagram one at the weekend. And apparently, I'm a nine. And I looked up to see what an Enneagram 9 person was, because obviously the website that I did it on, it was like, give us your email to get your results, and you can open your results by sending us some money. And I was like, no, I don't think so. So I just Googled elsewhere to find out what an Enneagram 9 was. And oh my God, it was so me. It was like the peacekeeper, the mediator, the person who doesn't like conflict, the person who generally puts other people's happiness before their own, who will always, sort of sit in the background. And I thought, yeah, that's definitely me. Enneagram, Enneagram. You can do like a personality test thing, and just sort of find out who you are. The Myers-Briggs one is where people say they're like, oh, I'm an INTF or an INTJ or something. And I can never remember which one I am of those, but I think I'm INT something. I don't know which one. Hello? You want my driver's license? Oh, bear with. There you go. Aren't you lucky I keep it tanned? What did Mango get Becca? Nothing. Nothing. Her adoration and love, I guess. Can I put it in Discord? Yeah, sure. Hang on. Let me move stuff. Let me see if I can find the link that I did the test on. Just bear with, bear with, bear with. No, that wasn't the one that I used. Where's the one that I used? This is the Enneagram personality test that I took. And Enneagram 9, I find so Enneagram type 9 is the peacemaker. So let me show you that. And that was my sort of result for me. So the easygoing, self-effacing type, receptive, reassuring, agreeable, and complacent. I don't know if I'm complacent, but it says here my basic fear is of loss and separation. My basic desire is to have inner stability and peace of mind. My key motivations are to want to create harmony in their environment, to avoid conflicts and tension, to preserve things as they are, and to resist whatever would upset or disturb them, which is me to a T. And then it gives you a whole list of people that were Enneagram Nines. I'm just seeing if there's anything that pops out. They would rather melt into someone else or quietly follow their idyllic daydreams. They demonstrate the universal temptation to ignore the disturbing aspects of life and to seek degrees of peace and comfort by numbing out. They respond to pain and suffering by attempting to live in a state of premature peacefulness, whether it is in a state of false spiritual attainment or in gross denial. More than any other type, nines demonstrate the tendency to run away from the paradoxes and tensions of life by attempting to transcend them or by seeking to find simple and painless solutions to their problems. Now, I will do that. Anywhere I can find a painless solution to a problem, that is what I will look for every single time. It says to emphasize the pleasant in life is not a bad thing, of course, but it is a limited and limiting approach to life. If nines see the silver lining in every cloud as a way of protecting themselves from the cold and rain, other types have their distorting viewpoints too. Nines focus on the bright side of life so that their peace of mind will not be shaken. But rather than deny the dark side of life, what nines must understand is that all the perspectives presented by the other types are true too. So yeah, and then it gives all these different things, who you're compatible with, who you misidentify with, possible addictions. Oh God. Do you want to hear the addictions? Oh my God. So, we're susceptible, apparently, according to this, to overeating or undereating due to lack of self-awareness and repressed anger, a lack of physical activity, depressants and psychotropics, alcohol, marijuana, or narcotics to deaden loneliness and anxiety. Well, I don't do any of those apart from antidepressants, but I'm not addicted to them. I just take them because I've been told to take them. Then there's a whole load of personal growth recommendations and then further reading. So once you find out what your type is, let me reset up my desk now. Once you find out what your type is, because it will tell you what your number is, but it won't tell you what that number then means. You can just go in and Google what does that number mean, and another website will tell you. So that's where I got all my stuff. So I know it's just a bit of fun. At the end of the day, it's just a bit of fun. I like doing things like that. I always used to love, whenever I was a young teenager, which, yes, so many years ago, how on earth do I remember it? But whenever there used to be like a questionnaire in a magazine, or find out your personality type, find out your perfect best friend, find out your perfect job, find all those sort of questionnaires and quizzes and things like that. I love those things. Absolutely love those things. I know they're just for fun, but it used to surprise me how often it got my personality absolutely spot on. Damn it. Need to use this protection thing better. You have to buy it. Yeah, that's why. No, don't buy it. Just do the test. Just do the test. And don't buy the results. Just, it will tell you what your number is. And then you can just Google the rest. No, don't buy it. No. Or Google another website if you don't want to, if you're worried about it's going to make you pay for something. Don't ever pay for something like that. You can always find the test for free. But I just remember thinking that I looked it up because I'd been watching a writing video, like an interview with a writer, and she was talking about how when she's creating characters, she will do Enneagram tests for them. And I was like, oh, okay, that's interesting. I've heard of people doing like, the personality tests and writing character questionnaires, but I'd never heard of doing Enneagrams. And I thought, I've never actually done that, so I must go and have a look. And so, a typical thing for me, send me down a rabbit hole. And I ended up doing one of the quiz just to find out what I was, or supposedly it was meant to be. But if you do do the quiz, if you do the quiz, you'll have to let me know what number you are. Do. Right now, that was the starting blue. Let's go a little shade darker. Really looking forward to getting started on these scales, these neck scales. But those quizzes, they're a good little tool for, I can see why people use them for character creation, why they use the Myers-Briggs tests as well. I think I would much prefer to use those to get ideas for different characters, for working out people's character traits and things like that. I don't tend to use like star signs or anything like that because I don't really have characters that obsess about star signs and what their characters should be like, because I don't think about star signs or anything like that. So I think going by, you know, these different personality tests, because there are meant to be certain types of established personality types, and you can see it on a scale from lots and lots of studies. So I would much rather, you know, do it from something that's got some not scientific backing, but some psychological, cognitive research to it. I think sometimes as writers we can get very stuck on writing characters that are exactly the same as us, because there's always an element of you in each of the characters that you put onto the page or onto the screen, because you are very much writing from your own experience and your own thoughts and opinions. And you have to remember when you create characters that sometimes you have to have characters that have a different world viewpoint than you and different experiences than you. So that makes them into a person that you never could be. And maybe a person that you don't particularly like, but you have to create them so that you have this variety of characters on the page, because otherwise it'll be very much of the sameness, wouldn't it? So if you can find these little tools to help, then, you know, go for it. Am I getting my driving license back? Okay, I'll do it later. Thank you. We're trying to set up insurance because Becca got herself a vehicle today. You're an eight. Okie dokie. So what does that mean? What is the overwhelming? What is the name? Because like mine is called the Peacemaker. So what is yours called? Right, let me just. Eights have enormous willpower, even though I put that I have no willpower. Let's have a look. So Enneagram 8 is called the Challenger, it says here. Yeah, the Challenger. The powerful, dominating type. Ooh. Self-confident, decisive, willful, and confrontational, whereas I avoid confrontation. So we're complete opposites there. It says your basic fear is of being harmed or controlled by others. Your basic desire is to protect yourself, to be in control of your own life and destiny. You want to be self-reliant, to prove your strength and resist weakness, to be important in the world, to dominate the environment and to stay in control of their situation. Do you think that's you? The opposite of the things that I put. It says you're charismatic and you have the physical and psychological capacities to persuade others to follow them into all kinds of endeavors, from starting a company to rebuilding a city to running a household to waging war to making peace. Wow. It says here your addictions would be ignoring physical needs and problems. Oh, I've got a bad neck issue. No, I'm not going to go to the doctors. No, I'm fine. So, tick. Avoids medical visits and checkups. Yeah. Indulges in rich foods, alcohol, tobacco, while pushing self too hard leads to high stress, control issues central. Wow. Don't worry, lads, if it all goes tits up, I'll rebuild the city. But there you go, Jamie. Rebuild. You shall rebuild us. So you can start the war, and I'll be the peacemaker that comes in and calms everybody down. And hold on now. Wait a minute. Right, what is the best blue to do this next bit? There's still an element going down. Down to about here. Okay. I feel cold now. Oh dear. Don't feel called out. It's fine. It's fine. It's all a bit of fun. this goes down to about the blue here, doesn't it? So let's just fill that in, and then I'll start to change the color. Starting to get there. It's not doing too badly, I don't think. Put it in full view. So this bit down here is the tree, and here we have some of the greenery and some more of the tree coming out in front of it. So I'm trying to do the dragon first, because the dragon's here and the tree comes over the top. So that is what I'm trying to do. That one needs to be really light blue because it's got like a creamy yellow in it as well. I'm wondering. Whether to put. I want to put some of the cream over it now. This might be a bit strong. I don't want to turn it green, but we'll see. That's not too bad, actually. Oh, actually, that's not too bad. Hey, Haley! Resubscribed for 9 months. Oh, my goodness. Welcome back. 9 months is crazy. I was just saying to James over at the weekend that in like three months I'll have been streaming for a year, and it's just crazy tunes. It's crazy to me. The time has gone so quickly. It just goes to show that time really does fly when you're having fun. I think what I might do is I might put a little grey over the top of this just to dull down some of the greeny tones that have come in through that. But what's going to be the best grey? The warm grey? Let's try that. Yeah, perfect. I've been really reluctant to reach for the greys because this is such a vibrant coloured dragon. Tones down some of that green. Did You have a good weekend, Haley. Dragon is looking amazing. Oh, thanks, thanks. It really does. That's why it feels like I've been sub to James for 40 years. Well, I don't know how long has James been streaming? I don't know. Probably a decent amount of time now. It was good to find out that one of my canaries is expecting another one. Baby birdies! Oh my goodness! Oh! I mean, hang on though. Stupid question incoming. How do you know your canary is expecting? Don't they just lay eggs and then you're like, oh, okay, yeah, there's eggs, so it's going to be a mama. It's not like you take it in for a little ultrasound, is it? You just sort of see, are you pregnant? Or are there like obvious signs a canary will show if it's creating eggs? I genuinely don't know. I genuinely don't know. When it's nesting and has laid eggs. Okay, right, okay. So I wasn't asking a stupid question. Morning sickness. Oh dear. Yeah. Just imagine your canary getting the gyps every morning. Oh, that's so sweet. How many eggs? How many eggs has your birdie laid? I think there is about four or five, but they lay between two to six. Oh my goodness. Right, okay, so I have more questions now. So how long do they sit on the eggs? How long does it take for the eggs to hatch? Are we talking weeks? Are we talking days? Have you had this happen before? Are you going to keep the babies? I mean, I just have so many questions. I'm so excited. Babies, baby birdies, little tweety pies. I thought a pretty cat. Tell Becca now. How was my weekend? Sorry, I didn't answer that bit. I knew there was something I'd not answered. Yeah, my weekend was fine. I had a great weekend. It was nice and relaxing and restful. The kids have bought me Minecraft, so I'll be streaming Minecraft soon. So, yeah, that happened. Doing all right. We're doing all right with these scales. I need just a little bit though of almost a little bit of yellow light. Let me sharpen that before I use it. So 2 weeks from the day they are laid, they lay one a day. All right, okay, so that, right, okay, yeah. Some of my other canaries had five little ones, but I only got one of those left because sometimes life can be cruel. Oh, yeah. Yeah, I think that is the case, isn't it? When animals produce a lot, it's normally because there is a mortality rate. But oh well, I mean, fingers crossed, Hayley. Fingers crossed that things go really, really well. I lost one back in January, so we went and bought another one. Oh. So is it the new one that has laid the eggs? There, that gives the impression of a little bit of light on that scale. And let me just put a little hint of it here as well. Just a little hint. The new one is the one that's laid eggs. Right, okay. Oh, that's so nice, though. Because didn't like, when you look back through history and everything, it's right, the 1700s, 1800s, 1900s, families would have like 9, 10 children because the mortality rate for children and childbirth was so high that, only a few would survive. So I guess we all do it in a way. Families are so much smaller these days because, we've made childbirth so much safer, and with, vaccinations and stuff, more children survive and don't succumb to a lot of the childhood illnesses that would sort of take them out really early. I mean, because we found that out. Because Nick does a lot of ancestry, and he sort of has researched like the family trees and stuff, and you only have to go back a couple of generations, 3, 4 generations, and find couples on both sides of our families that had 10, 11 children, but say 3 or 4 lived. And so, are we talking about vaccines? We're just talking about not vaccines specifically, but just the fact that these days it is safer for children to survive past birth and the first year or two of their lives. I thought it was because TVs wasn't invented, so there was nothing else to do. No, I don't think so. I think they had plenty to do, Jamie. They had to make everything from scratch, remember? Right, I need. What is going to be the best color for this now? Maybe go for that more of a dark sepia color. Right, now I need to bring. Let's do this. Yeah, this ivory. Ivory to begin with. How are you doing, Living Frost? Anyway, I didn't say hello to you. Hello. How are you doing? Are you okay? Right, now I need this blue to sort of fade into it a little bit more. Right, and I need might do that cream color. This is the yes, yeah, this is the 102, this is the cream. I don't use this one much because it's such a weird color, but it fits this part of the dragon scales, so in it goes. Oh, so I have more direction for my story. I was going to end my story with a forced duel between friends, but I'm moving towards the middle of the story. Then I'm going to use that as torment that he struggles with, which will lead to conflict between three kingdoms. Excellent! Excellent! I'm glad that you've worked out your direction and how you're going to use what you were talking about before. That's really good. I found I've very much found that I really do need to take more time to sit and plan my stories. I've found what I'm comfortable in with my romance stories, because the last book that I wrote and is currently sitting with my editor, awaiting revisions, was out of my comfort zone to some degree due to the setting and the vocation of the hero and the heroine. Hey Liz, how are you doing? But this story that I'm currently writing, because obviously I've started my new book, my new romance, the one that I'm writing there, I've gone back to a setting of a typical English country village. So, and I've done a lot of stories in English country villages, and I find that I'm a lot more comfortable writing those, and the writing for that one is going a lot better. But I've also worked out that even though I usually start with, I know my start, I know my end, I know a couple of points in the middle, and I sort of discovery write my way through the middle, making sure I touch on those points, I've now realized that the more I plan, the more fixed points I have, makes my writing go a lot smoother and is less stressful to me. So I've very much discovered that over the last couple of weeks that I really do need to just plan more, and then that makes everything just go a little bit better. Yeah, I'm good. Happy birthday, by the way. Happy birthday. Happy birthday, Liz. It's Liz's birthday. Everyone say happy birthday. Wish her a good day. Are you going to go out for your birthday, or are you just going to stay in and shoot people on Valorant? Do I deal with a lot of revising for my books? Sometimes, yes. There have been some books where I have had. I generally have one good set of revisions, and then maybe a tiny bit of revisions will come in a second round. But the book that had the most revisions was my third book that I ever wrote, and it had five big sets of revisions. And I found those so stressful and so upsetting. I was tearing my hair out with them, and it was just I actually remember one situation in that book that I swore I would never let it happen to me ever again, because I sent the book in, it came back with its first lot of revisions, and my editor basically said, this particular character, I don't like this character, they shouldn't be in there, they add nothing to the story, so could you please take them out? So that sounds a simple thing, just take a character out. But if that character is throughout the book, or people refer to them throughout the book, you have to take out every single reference. And then once you take all that out, you have to fill it with something else, because obviously your word count drops, and you have to be a certain word count with the Mills and Boon books. And so I can remember taking that character out and refilling it with something else. I don't even remember what I refilled it with. And then sending those revisions back in. And then getting a third set of revisions coming back, where the editor's saying, actually, you know what? The story doesn't work without that character in it, so we need you to bring that character back. And I was just, what? Are you kidding me? Sort of thing. It was like I had worked so hard. It had taken me like a month to take everything out and strip it back. And then suddenly they were saying, well, actually, no, I think I've made a mistake. I think you need to bring that character back in. And so I sort of tried to put them in a smaller way because obviously there was still the initial complaint of they don't add too much to the story, but they were obviously still needed. And I put that character back in. And then I can remember thinking, right, okay, that's it. We've sorted that story out now and sent the third lot of revisions back in. And then the fourth lot of revisions arrived, and it was all to do with all these other different aspects of the story. And at that point, I was just like, you don't know how to write. You don't know what you're doing. The editor doesn't know what to do with your book. You're a crappy writer. You're really bad. And I had this massive, massive amount of self-doubt, and I'm gonna quit. I'm not gonna do this ever again. Why would anyone put themselves through this? Because I'm very good at beating myself up with stuff. And yeah, I tackled that fourth set of revisions and sent them back in and said to my husband, I am not going to look at that book ever again. This had better be it. This had better be it because there's no way I want to read that story again. I've read it like 175 gazillion times, with rereading and redrafting and going through. And I was just like, no, I can't bear it. And I'd been crying and, really berating myself really quite badly. And then a fifth lot of revisions turned up. And I tell you, Living Frost, I was so close to the edge of this is it. I'm not gonna take another contract. I'm just not, because no, this is too much. If this is what every book is going to be like, then I can't do this. But it only happened on that one book. And it sounds horrendous, and I can smile about it now, but I was still a baby writer. I was still a baby writer on my third book, and I'd been lulled into a false sense of security because my second book went through with barely any revisions at all. And I was like, hey, I've cracked this. I know what I'm doing, sort of thing. And it turned out that no, I didn't know what I was doing. And yeah, so revisions. I don't like doing revisions because of that experience. And yeah, I think because my last story, like I said, I was very uncomfortable with my setting and my hero's choice of job. He was a plastic surgeon, and I didn't know too much about plastic surgery. So I very much felt like I was feeling my way through the story, not exactly knowing what I was doing with it. So I am expecting there to be an awful lot of revisions coming back to me on that last story, which I'm not looking forward to because I didn't really enjoy the last book writing it. It was a difficult experience. I dreaded sometimes coming to my desk every day to do the words, but you have to get the words done. So yeah, we'll just have to wait and see. So I'm wait any day now. I'm gonna get revisions from my editor, and I'm dreading her email dropping into my inbox. You're out eating brunch with your parents. Oh, lovely. Okay, so that's nice. That's nice. Good, good, good. Think I'm just going to mark out the neck. And then I'll see where we are. That has to be really tough. I've asked someone else. They'd mentioned that the publisher worked with her because they weren't trying to change the book, mainly changing what wasn't working. But hearing how you put it, it sounds dreadful. It was just that one experience. Most editors, if you get a good editor, will work with you with what you've already got. They won't try and vastly change the story. But on that occasion, I was writing a secret baby trope. And secret baby tropes are really hard to write if you've never done them before. And I wanted to write one because I'd read a good one and I was like, oh, I want to do a story like that. That's really cool. And actually, no, let me change this. This needs to be in the dark blue again. Please don't let it put you off. I hope I haven't put you off. I just had an experience that was just... I tried something really ambitious. And like I said, I was still a baby writer. And I was also at the stage where I thought that if an editor sends you an editorial letter, that everything that they put in there, you have to change. That is what I used to believe. I used to think, well, they've put it in there for a reason, so I've got to change it. But it wasn't until later, speaking with other authors and discovering that when an editor gives you a revision letter, they are suggestions. They are guidelines. They are not orders. And you as an author have to have the wherewithal and the strength of character to say, I'm not changing that point. I'm sorry, I don't agree with you. I understand what you're saying and I can see where you're coming from, but I don't agree with you on that point. So I will not be changing that point. And now when I do my revisions, I will read through a revision letter. I will highlight the ones that I agree with and the ones that I am prepared to do. And then I will work my way through the list. I would do all the little changes first. So even, you know, just little simple tweaks that literally just take one or two words to change. And then I will go through and tackle the larger revisions. And as I say, I will only do the ones that I absolutely agree with. And then when I send those revisions back, I don't even say to the editor, oh, I disagreed with this. I don't agree with what I don't even say any of that. I just say, thanks for your revision letter. I've been through and made certain changes. I hope you find them enjoyable. Please let me know your thoughts. Warmest wishes, Nick. And that's it. I don't say, I disagree with you. You're wrong or anything like that. It's just, you just have to understand at the end of the day, it's your story. It's your creation. Hey, Artsy. It's your story. It's your creation. And it's your world. It's your characters. Someone can come in with a fresh set of eyes, which is absolutely what you need on a story. But you don't have to agree with everything that they say. I just think that it would be hard because you're putting a part of yourself into your creative process, and then to have an editor tear it down would be aggravating. Yes. Yeah, I agree. There is that element of it. You just develop... You develop a bit of a thick skin. Because I find that when I write a story and I send it in and I think, well, that's good. That is good. I feel that when I send it in, I'm sending them in a good story. And so for them to come in and want to tear it to pieces, it's like, what are you doing to my baby? What are you doing? You know, that's a good story. Why are you trying to ruin it? But it's better when you get a revision letter just to sort of, your initial reaction will be to go, no, not doing it. No, my story is fine. No, absolutely not. It's just, you just, I don't know. It's best to just let a revision letter sit for a while, for a day, maybe 2 days, and then go back in and read it when you're not so raw and you don't have that knee-jerk reaction because you've already read everything that they've said. So you're thinking about, okay, well, maybe they've got a point with XYZ. Maybe I'll consider changing that. Maybe I will do this particular change and we'll see how it goes. And generally, when you get to the end of that revision letter and you've gone through all the bits that you want to change, you do realize at the end of it that you do have a slightly stronger story or a very much stronger story than what you started off with. It's just working out what you're going to do. Hey, Admiral, has listening to everything an editor said led to you making changes you later regretted in your work? Oh, good question. I think probably in the beginning, yes, I think in the beginning, like I say, when I was a baby writer, because I used to think, as I said before, that if an editor suggested something, if they put in their letter, oh, I think this scene would work better if, and then they give their reasons. I used to think that that was, you must change this scene. And so I would change the scenes. And now, as a more experienced writer, shall we say, because I'm old and wise, I know now that I shouldn't have done every single change that they asked of me, and that I could just do make the changes that I wanted to change. My very first book, just as an example, I like how should we say? Because I also like writing horror and everything, right? Just as a declaration here, I like detail. I like gory detail. So when I write medical scenes, I would write in my very first book, I wrote this very detailed scene of a woman. I'm trying to think how to say this right. So a woman had just given birth because it was set in a maternity ward. A woman had just given birth, but I wanted to have an emergency situation, and so I decided to give her a trigger warning for anyone that this, you know, who is triggered by descriptions of blood or bleeding. So turn off if that triggers you. But in this particular scene, I decided to give this woman a postpartum hemorrhage. And so I very much described the blood coming out and the sound of it hitting the floor. My editors went absolutely nuts and said, no, this is escapist fantasy. This is a romance. This is not a horror novel. You need to dial all your descriptions back. And I really hated when I read that scene back, how tame and what I considered it to be a little bit not real. Because I've witnessed a postpartum hemorrhage. I've not had one myself, but I've witnessed one. And I've seen it in various shows where it's been expressed. And so I have a general idea of what it looks like, what it sounds like, what it smells like. And I wanted to put those five, the five senses, so to speak, into the story and really make it detailed. And they made me dial everything back and say no. And I wished I had stuck to my guns and kept in some of the realism, because I thought it was an order to take everything back. But it wasn't. It was just a recommendation. A toad with a glove in its mouth sounds scary. Yeah, I do things like that. Right, a toad with a glove in its mouth. Right, hang on. Let me get my pencil. Right, it's a toad. Why a toad with a glove in its mouth? Oh, you hang on. You said you posted another sketchbook cover. Let me just go and have a look at the book cover. Ooh, let me enlarge that. That's very fantasy D&D sort of stuff going on, isn't it? That's really good. I like the little character with the bow. She's got a really sort of naughty look on her face. As if like, ha ha ha, look what I've just done. Are those Prismacolor? No, these are Faber-Castell Polychromos that I use exclusively. I use those. So they're the pencils that I use. And I use Bristol board, Strathmore Bristol board vellum paper. Right, so a toad with a glove in its mouth. Oh my God. Oh no. You make me draw something really bad. God, oh God, no, this looks almost, this is, I'm doing like a mitten. It looks like something. Well, let's not even say what it looks like. I wanted it to have cute little cheeks, but that don't look like a toad. No, let me start again. Let me start again because I'm gonna have to Google what a toad looks like. Oh my God, imagination. It looked like a glove to me, okay? It looked like a glove to me, and then as I was drawing it, I thought, no, this don't look like a glove. Toad. This is why I have to have like something in front of me so I can see what I'm doing. Right, okay. So I sort of got the mouth thing. So if I do like, let's actually put. Fingers. The glove, then maybe it won't look so dodgy. See already, see? Can you tell the difference when I'm looking at something? How hungry is this toad? Wow. do little bumps here because toads have a little bumpy back, don't they? And this is, let's give him some warts. This bit is my own creation. Go me! The glove is mine. The glove and the warts is my own creation. There we go. Little fat toad. What should we call him? You can't sculpt toads either. Barney. Okay. Barney. There we go. I feel like I need to colour the glove in. So hang on. Just so we can make it distinguishable from the toad. I have a dark glove. And then I've got my greens out, so let's do a green for the toad. Let's give him some colour. This is why it's always a danger asking me to doodle anything. Right, that's that bit. And then if I just use a little bit, when I get caught sneaking a late night snack. Like, well, who, me? No, I'm not eating anything. No, absolutely not. Let's put a little bit of shadow on here. This will be the dark bit, won't it? That's next to the floor. There we go. Little Barney. He looks so cute. He's not bad, actually. But I would not have been able to have drawn that by myself. I mean, we all saw where I was going with that, didn't you? Oh, right. Okay. So, that is where I'm going to leave it today, guys. Say bye-bye to Barney. So that's where I'm going to leave it today. That's how much I've done of the dragon so far. So he's coming along. He's doing all right. Or she. What did we agree to call it? We agreed to call this dragon something. Was it? Is it Aaron? 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 Something like that. I think we agreed to call it. But yeah, I'm quite pleased with it at the moment. I think I've just got all this to do in... I've got the yellow and then a bit more blue to do. And then I think... Oh, there's a front foot of the dragon that I haven't done yet. But I think I'll try and do this tree after we've done the full neck of the dragon and then go on to some of the surroundings and and stuff and see how we go. But yeah, not too bad. How do I know what colors to use? Ooh. I have no idea. I have the pic, right? Okay, what I do, like, I have the picture in front of me on my iPad, and so I just sort of zoom in on certain areas and I just look at the colors that are there. I think about the color wheel. Okay, so I think about what colors are opposite each other, which colors complement each other and sit alongside each other in the color wheel. And if I'm not sure, I will start really, really lightly. So if I know, like on here, I knew I needed a blue under the eye, but I needed a really light blue. So I put in the lightest blue I could find, and then I slowly but surely started adding darker blues to it and putting darker blues around it. And then I sort of added like the bits of purple that I could see and slowly started to blend them in. So I always start really, really light, because if I'm wrong, you can still change it. If you go in too dark straight away, there's no way you can lift that and change it. So I try and go in as light as possible first, and then when I feel comfortable with my light color and think, yeah, okay, this is heading in the right direction, then I start adding deeper colors on top of that. And I draw what I can see, not what I think I can see. So what I mean by that is, like, for the toad, for example, you look at most toads and frogs and you think, okay, in your head, most people will think a frog or a toad is green and will just draw green. And yes, I have drawn green on here because this is just a doodle and it's a sketch. But if I was drawing an actual frog, and actually, if you look in the slideshow, there is a tree frog in there somewhere. And not all frogs are green. They are brown and some are black and some are blue and some are bright red. And you have to look at the colors and realize that, oh, there's black there in the eye because the center of the eye is black, so therefore they must always be black. But when you look at the photo, if it's actually showing you that's a shade of brown and grey, then put brown and grey in. Don't paint or draw what you think is going to be there. If you're going from a reference photo, draw what you can actually see. And sometimes it can be really, really weird. As these guys will tell you, the very first picture I did, which is also in the slideshow below, was a golden retriever puppy that we called Derek. And so, as you can imagine, with a golden retriever, you have, blonde golden fur. But I got my purple pencil out because I could see purple around the eye. Now, if you looked at a dog, a golden retriever, you wouldn't think there was any purple on there at all. But when I looked at the photo, I could clearly see that there was purple in the dark brown skin around the eye, so I put the purple in. And so it's about drawing what you can see, not drawing what you expect to see or what you think you expect to see. So it's just, it becomes instinct after a time as well, I think, that look, there's the golden retriever. So in that dark brown skin around the eye, there's actually purple. But it all just helps to add to the realism, because I like to try and go for realism. You have to go with all the colors. So blacks are never usually made up of black. Whites are never normally made up of whites. You have to look at what those colors are reflecting from the area around them. So sometimes you get like green from the trees or the grass will reflect upon the fur, and so you put in green, where you wouldn't think, oh, why am I putting green on a dog, or why am I putting purple on a dog? But if it matches the photo, then put it in, and it so adds to the realism, and it really helps. And it's just about really studying the picture that you're trying to reproduce. And so you get used to picking the colors that you've got as well. So with the Faber-Castell, I've got a full set, so I've got the full 120 colors. So you start to learn which colors you've actually got in your tool set. Couldn't think of the words there for a minute. And another thing you can do is, when you get a set of colors, is to do a swatch. So get the paper that you're going to be using, and then on the paper, just sort of start off with a light bit and then add further pressure, so you make that pencil go really dark, and you'll know, okay, so this is the phthalo blue 110, and that's what that one looks like. Whereas if I use the mauve, I can start off really light, and then I start to add in, and you can see the color range that you can get with each pencil. So when you're first starting out, you can have a look to say, all right, I need that purple there, so that's mid pressure, and so you know to use this pencil with a mid pressure to get that particular purple. The only thing doing a swatch doesn't show you is how those colors blend. So you can always practice on a side bit of paper before you do coloring in, just to see what it looks like. So I've put in a light layer of the blue, but if I want to blend in the purple, I'm going to put that over the top and just see what it looks like blending. Do I need it to be darker at this end? Who knows? You just keep doing it until you see whether you get the blend that you want to achieve. If you don't get it with that color, then you try it with something else. And eventually you'll get used to blending your colors, layering your colors, and working out the amount of pressure that you need to use on your pencil. Oh, there's an ad disrupting my explanation. Okay. All right. Let's wait a minute. We'll be back in a minute. This way, the ad ends in 7 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And we're back. Sorry about the ad. Sorry about the ad. So I don't know which bit I got up to. So here I was just saying that, you do the dark from one end to the light to the other end, and so you can work out how much pressure you need to do with each one. And then when you're practicing drawing or trying to do a drawing, have a scrap piece of that paper at the side, and when you're not sure which colors you need to blend, just do it on the side. Like here, I just mixed the blue with the purple just because I have those colors to hand, and I would just practice on the side to think, okay, that blue and that purple creates that color, and it's not quite what I need, so I'm going to go in with a deeper blue and put that over the purple and see if that helps. And you just keep experimenting until you just get used to how the pencils work with each other. And it's best to do that with the different sets of pencils that you've got, because they will all work in a different way. So the Prismacolors will blend different to the Faber-Castell. I've got the Faber-Castell Pitt pastels as well. So I've got pastel pencils, which I'm not very good at. So I practice a lot of with these because I'm still not confident using the pastels. I've also got, do I have them around here? No, I don't have them to hand. Damn it. But I have some watercolor pencils. I have luminance pencils as well, the Caran d'Ache luminance. And so they need to be treated differently as well. So it's worth doing a swatch to begin with. And just getting to know what each pencil will do. Because sometimes as well, you can look at a pencil and think, yeah, that's purple. But when you, that isn't always the color that you see when you put it down on the paper. So it's, you can't always tell from a pencil just by looking at it. You have to know what you're going to get by actually putting it down on the paper. And also take into account, sorry, this is a really long-winded explanation, but I'm trying to be as thorough as I possibly can. The color of your background paper will also change how your pencils appear. So I'm just using a white, but if you're using a cream or a soft gray or black paper, your pencils are going to look completely different on that paper. So always do a test swatch first of the colors that you want to use and see if they're going to match what you're going to try and achieve with your drawing. You usually use Bristol. Okay, yeah, it's, I've tried lots of different papers. I've tried the, oh God, what's it called? I'm trying to think what the other papers are called, and my mind is just drawing a blank at the moment. But I've just found that the Bristol, the Strathmore Bristol Board Vellum works best for me. That's the paper I like using. I've used more textured papers. The aqua, oh, that's it, aquarels, the watercolor aquarel paper. I've tried that and I really struggle to get my pictures looking the way I want them to look. So anyway, that was a really long-winded way of saying how do you get the colors. So there we go. Anyway, that's it for today then, guys. I'm gonna leave it there. I'm gonna take away Barney and put him away. I'm gonna put the little dragon away in a moment. And so tomorrow, I don't know what we're gonna do tomorrow. Oh, no problem, no problem at all. I don't. I happy to explain. Happy to explain. I don't know when to do Minecraft. I think I might save Minecraft for Wednesday, because that would normally be the night I would play Valo and. I thought, well, I'll put Minecraft in there instead. So tomorrow will probably be this again. But I may change my mind. Who knows? It might be Minecraft tomorrow. No, Minecraft will be Wednesday. Minecraft will be Wednesday for those who definitely want to be there to see me embarrass myself trying to work out Minecraft. So, yeah. Right, okay, guys, that's where I'm going to leave it. Thanks so much for spending time with me this evening. I really appreciate your company as always, that you choose to spend it with me. I really appreciate that. So I hope you all have a fabulous rest of your day, wherever you are in the world, and take care of yourselves. And I will see you here tomorrow night. Round about 6 o'clock. 6 o'clock, Jamie. Not 5:30, but about 6 o'clock. Maybe a little bit before. But yeah. So anyway, have a good night, everybody. Take care. Bye.